comes and a lullaby.
Tommy Sands grew up in, not Houston, but you grew up in Shreveport, Louisiana. You're from Chicago, you said.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Chicago, Illinois.
Born in Chicago and raised in the South, raised in Louisiana and Texas.
Shreveport, though. Wow.
Shreveport.
What a great place to grow up in.
Oh, yeah.
Got a guitar. Tell me about the guitar at a young age.
Well, I used to listen to the radio when my mother went to work at about 5 o'clock in the morning,
right?
Because we lived about 10 miles outside of town, she had to catch the bus, so there was nothing to do after she got up. And
right.
I used to listen to the radio, and they had all these great country and western singers on the radio at 5, 5:30, 6 o'clock. Uh-huh. That was the home of the Louisiana Hayride,
right?
Which is where Elvis came from, and me, and a lot of other people, Hank Williams. So it was a great Shreveport was a great hub of music,
of country music.
Yeah, when I was growing up. Mm-hmm.
But you got a guitar at a young age. And you worked clubs at 12, 13, 14. Tell me
yeah,
about
Yeah, even younger than that.
Really?
When I was 10.
Mm-hmm. You worked clubs at 10? Nightclubs?
Mm-hmm. Not real nightclubs. They were like taverns.
Oh,
you know,
okay.
What you might
what
call
do you mean,
a
taverns?
Honky-tonk.
Where they serve liquor, Tommy.
That's right, yeah.
What do you mean, you got there and sang? What kind of songs you used to do?
Country and Western.
Did you really?
Mm-hmm.
But when you were in Houston, there was this man, Elvis Presley, who discovered Elvis Presley, Tom Parker.
Right.
Colonel Parker
mm-hmm.
saw this young man by the name of Tommy Sands, was it going by?
Mm-hmm. That's my real name.
He saw this young man. He grabbed you, didn't he? So tell me what happened.
Well, I was playing rhythm guitar for a guy in his band in Houston, and Colonel Parker came in one night. He was a friend of the band leader.
Right.
And he called me over after the first set, and I was 12, and he signed me up.
He did sign you up right away.
Yeah, and then he got me... a record contract with RCA, and we did about seven records when I was a kid.
The first song that you recorded RCA mm-hmm. was Hush a Cush. What was that?
Oh, it was.
You remember?
I wrote it. Yeah, it was called Love Pains, and the other side of it was called Serp, Sop, and Blues.
That's it. That's it. That's it. Serp, Sop, and Blues. You write all your songs.
Well, I write a lot of them. Yeah.
Uh huh. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I think the one you were talking about
Crush.
Was later, when I was about, I went with Capitol, and my first hit was called Teenage Crush.
That's it, Teenage Crush.
That was it.
You, because you started so young.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Teenage Crush came in later, at what age?
18, I think, 18 or 19.
Tommy Sands, so young. You were working clubs, you mean Parker was shipping you around clubs or just recording or what?
Well, I was doing clubs, you know, on my own, and then he found me. And then he would do the bigger things for me, like I'd go out and open shows for Hank Williams and Eddy, Arnold, things like that.
Uh-huh.
But then when I'd go home, I'd continue to work these little taverns or honky-tonks or whatever you call them. And... he would do the big shows for me.
So you were the opening act for all these great stars like Eddie Arnold.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Elvis Presley, too.
Elvis Presley, too.
Tell mm-hmm. me about Elvis Presley and Eddie Arnold. I mean, these are two great names, though, Tommy.
Oh,
you were
yeah.
just a kid.
Yeah.
As an opening
mm-hmm.
act.
Mm-hmm.
Why did he do that, I wonder? What did you see him doing that as a 12-year-old? Because you must have been really great at 12. But why did he put you on an opening act with these two people? He was trying to build your career.
Yeah, he was trying to build me up because he thought that when I got to be 18 or 19, 20, that he would, you know, he'd have a chance with me.
Uh-huh.
And so he wanted to start building me. And he did a really, well, he's a genius, I think, at show business. He's still alive, you know.
Yes.
And
what makes him such a genius, Tommy?
You've got me. But he is.
And he has a great eye.
He has a great eye. He found Elvis Presley. Before that, he found Eddie Arnold. Before that, he found the guy in the 20s. His first big act was in the 1920s. It was a guy named Gene Austin, My Blue Heaven.
My Blue Heaven.
Record sold 87 million records for RCA in the 20s.
Really?
And that was Colonel Parker again.
Nobody knew that. I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. Great eye.
Great eye. Elvis Presley, working with Elvis Presley. Tell me.
Greatest, the most charismatic, the most magical individual I've ever seen, both off screen, off stage, and on stage, on screen. He's the kind of person that could not walk into a room and not stop whatever was happening in that room. Every person whether it was a man or a woman, would turn and look at him.
Right.
He was that magical, you know. There was something about him, and you can't really define it with any kind of vocabulary. Uh-huh. We don't have the words that accurately tell you what that is. It's uh-huh. magic.
Tommy Sands, at 12 years old, working with Elvis Presley, or 13, looking at him. Did you watch his performance, watching all the performances?
I used to imitate him.
Did you really?
Yeah, and he used to love to see me do that. We'd go out clubbing after a show.
Right. And at 12 years old, 13, he used to take you out clubbing?
Yeah, because I was already working in him anyway,
uh-huh.
you know.
Okay.
And so he would ask me to get up and do him. Uh-huh. So I would do that.
What he used to talk about, actually? He didn't like to talk showbiz, did he?
Well, he liked to talk about girls.
Girls?
He liked girls a lot, and uh-huh. so did I.
Uh-huh.
Still do.
You certainly do.
And he used to talk about James Dean.
Jimmy
we
Dean.
We both liked Jimmy Dean a lot. And he knew then that someday he was going to be an actor, and he wanted to be an actor like Jimmy Dean.
Elvis did want to be an actor? Mm-hmm. He knew at that time?
Yeah,
and you
sure
knew,
did.
Because you did work mm-hmm. a lot of films when mm-hmm. you came out here. First of all, you substitute for Elvis's television show, didn't you do
right.
it? Tell me about that. How did that happen?
Well, that was Colonel Parker again.
Yeah.
When he finally signed a contract with Elvis, it had to be exclusive. Those were the conditions that Elvis's mother and father laid down. So all of the people that Colonel Parker represented, Eddie Arnold, myself,
right.
other people, we could no longer be working with him. He was just exclusive with Elvis. But we remained friends, and I came out here when I was almost 18. And I wanted to, you know, I was trying to get in movies, trying to get a break
right.
somehow.
Right.
And nothing was happening. One night I got a call from Colonel Parker, and he gave me a ticket and sent me back to New York to audition for this show, which was kind of the story of
the
Elvis Presley's life.
The right. Singing Idol. Mm-hmm.
And he got it for me. Uh-huh. They auditioned a lot of people, hundreds uh-huh. of people, and they couldn't find anybody.
Uh-huh.
And they went back to him, and he said, I got the guy for you. And so they took his word.
And that Tommy Sands' career just bombed, really carried on from there, didn't it?
Yeah. That was the show that I sang Teenage Crush in.
And that sold how many? Within weeks, I understand.
Within 1 week, it had sold a million records.
Did it really?
Yeah.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
That is
it's,
a lot.
It's different now. You know,
what
now,
so makes it so different now?
Well, there are a lot more kids, number one. There are a lot more people.
Uh-huh.
And the kids now have an awful lot of money to spend, and they like to spend it on records and movies and clothes.
Right.
And so, you know, the big stars in records are selling not just millions, but multi-millions of records. Some big record sellers now will sell 10, 12 million of one song.
Right, right. Tell me about Capitol Records. How many records did you make for them? You made a lot, didn't you?
Oh, hundreds, yeah. I was with them a long time.
Sing Boy Sing.
Mm-hmm.
Movie?
Movie.
Tell me
mm-hmm.
about that.
Well, that was the movie version of that first show that I did, The Singing Idol.
The Singing Idol.
Mm-hmm. And so my first picture with 20th was Sing Boy Sing.
Uh-huh. And what's The Worrying Kind? What's that about?
The Worrying Kind is another song that I did. It's a record that's.
I like that. I remember that.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Thank you, because it didn't sell well.
I know.
But it's out of all the songs I've ever done, I think it's the one that is remembered around the world.
Yes.
When I go to Europe, when I go to Asia.
I remember it in Germany when I was there.
Is that right?
Yes, I do. I remember it.
And
Blue Ribbon Baby too.
Blue Ribbon Baby. Yeah.
Yeah.
My guitar player wrote both those songs.
Uh huh.
And he was quite a guy.
Song you did is really great as I'll Be Seeing You.
I love that song.
Is that one of your favorite? What's your favorite song?
Of mine?
Of yours. Of your songs. Do you have a favorite? Or?
I think, yeah. I think probably my favorite would be The Worrying Kind of all the songs that I recorded.
Uh-huh.
I really liked it. And the reason I think I liked it is it was so natural. Scotty wrote it one day. We went in the next day and recorded it, and we got it on the first take. It was mm-hmm. just one of those things that was natural.
You are very dear friends with one of my favorites, a poet, Rod McCoon.
Right.
I love Rod McCoon.
So do I.
This man is so talented.
Mm.
You wrote a song with him or something.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about this. What was that?
Sing Boy Sing.
Was that?
We wrote the song.
The
for
movie
the picture.
Thing? Mm-hmm. Really?
Yeah.
How did you meet Rod McCoon?
When I first got out here, I was going. The first girl that I went with was a little singer here named Molly B. And Rod McCoon.
Molly B.
Molly B. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
And Molly B. introduced me to Rod. She was a good friend of his.
Right.
And he was under contract at the time to Universal.
Right.
And he was writing some wonderful songs at the time. He was writing some kind of folk songs.
Right.
That was before he really became a poet. And we got very friendly. And one day he stopped by my house and I was writing a song, Sing Boy Sing. I had no idea that it was going to wind up being accepted for the film, but I was just starting on it. And he said, let me help you. And he gave me the third or fourth line. And so we did it together. The next day I took it into the producer of the movie at 20th, and he said, let's change the title of the movie. And so they changed it from The Singing Idol to Sing Boy Sing.
You did a thing. First of all, I want to ask you about your mother and father. Your father divorced your mother when you were very young.
Right.
Your mother worked, worked for very little money. That's when you decided to go out and help her and played in clubs.
Right.
And you made something like $5, $6, $10 a night in the little clubs.
Yeah, I used to make $5
Tell me
bucks
about
a night.
Those must have been wonderful moments as a young boy, like a newsboy on a corner helping his mother, because you were the father. You were no, Tommy, really, I'm looking at you.
No, I'm just thinking.
That is so simpatico. It's so, it's kids today don't do that.
Well, it's a different world today, you know. I mean, we didn't know that we were poor. So many people say this, but it's true. You lived fairly well, even though my mom made $33 a week. She was a sales girl in a department store. And we needed some extra money, and I loved to sing. So that's how that started. And when I could make $5 here and there, it helped, and I loved doing it. But we were really poor, although, as I say, we didn't understand that.
Right.
And we lived very well. I remember my mother always had a nice apartment for us, and we had plenty to eat, and I had, you know, enough clothes to wear on my back. And eventually, as I started working more, we got our own car. We had the insurance for the car. So we didn't feel like we were deprived. But
so Tommy Sands, looking back at your whole life, you would say you had a good time?
Oh, yeah.
Would you?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say one thing. You got married to a wonderful lady, Sinatra, the clam. I mean, the Sinatra's clam. How did Tommy Sands get into that? How did you meet Nancy Sinatra?
Well, she came, I was working here at the Coconut Grove.
Right.
And
she was after you, I understand. That's what I was told. Go ahead.
And so she came back after the show and,
right.
and came back to my dressing room. And that, it was like an instant thing.
Was it really?
We started going out immediately,
And you stayed, how long were you married? How long have you been?
Well, we were together, I think, 6 years.
She got Tommy Sands and really chased Tommy Sands. She told everybody, this is the man I'm going to marry.
Oh.
This is the man I'm going to marry, and she married you.
She didn't tell me
that. Oh, she did? No? Was it a tough marriage for you at the after?
No? Well, it was, you know, it was my first marriage, so I had nothing to judge it by.
Right.
But we were very young, and I think in retrospect, if she probably, I don't know what she says about it, but that's what I would say. We were just really, really young. She was 17, I think.
She and was 17?
Yeah, and I was 20,
yeah,
something like that, or she was 18 and
you guys
I was 21.
Young. You guys were
young.
Yeah, and your careers, you both had careers at the time.
Well, she didn't yet.
The shoes didn't come out then, no.
You know,
no,
that was, no. That was later.
Yeah.
Yeah. But so she was a wonderful wife. She really was.
Did you insist that she should get in the business? Did she ask about this to you?
No, but she wanted to. And so we did a couple of records when we were married. And I remember I helped her with them. But she didn't really hit until I left. I think that was probably the best thing that ever happened to her. I always say I'm the reason she became a star.
Me and Sinatra, did you get along, you guys, at the beginning of
We always got along.
Yeah, I understand that.
He was, strangely enough, he was very, very soft and gentle, and he never intruded in our relationship.
Really?
Never.
Well, that's good.
When we were going with each other, when we were married, he was never like the overbearing type stepfather, you know,
that's
or father-in-law, rather.
That's what I always heard about Frank. I heard about Frank. He's always...
He just let her alone and let her do her own
thing. He does all his daughters the same way. Isn't James Ferrantino, all these people.
Well, I admire that. I think it's a wonderful quality, and I hope when my daughter gets married that I can be that way.
You did a movie with him. It was called None But the Braves. Tell me about that, working with Frank Sinatra. Well, did he get the part for you, or did you, how did that happen?
He probably got it for me.
Did he?
You know, yeah.
You're honest. That's what I like about you.
Yeah, he probably did, because at that time, I was a much bigger star, or much more successful before I met Nancy. And so when I met her, I was already beginning to go down somewhat. We were married, and then during the marriage,
how many times have you ever been down? People don't.
Well, I mean, you have a peak, and then you kind of.
Well, that's life. That's that's how we go.
You have your ups and downs.
Ups and downs, and it's good that way, because you'll find yourself better. Don't you feel you found yourself a little better when you're coming down to?
Well, I would love to just stay there.
Really, honey?
Frankly, sure. Why not? I mean, I'd love to be a gigantic star and die a gigantic star. But that's not the way life is. At least it wasn't that way for me.
Did Sinatra help you on the set with this movie, The Braves?
He was the director.
He was the director.
Gave me one of the... didn't give me. Uh-huh. He was telling Clint Walker, and one of the best lines
I ever
heard.
Clint Walker's in it.
Uh-huh. He was directing Clint in a scene, and he said, I think the brightest thing I've ever heard about life in general, not just acting,
right.
But Clint's a big man, and so when he would move, he would move in a gigantic step, and
right.
Sinatra said, just a second, he said, remember this, he said, just move very, very slowly and take little steps. He said, remember, life is just a matter of inches, and I never forgot that line. I think, he said, I always say life, but uh-huh. He said, acting is just a matter of inches. Uh-huh. And that was the kind of subtle actor that he was, uh-huh. You know.
What has been the hardest for Tommy Sands?
Making money.
Making money. Is it that important for you to everybody seems that worrying about money and success. Are you spiritual at all?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is it that important for Tommy Sands to be up there and making money?
It is. It is to me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's a spiritual side of me. There's a pragmatic side to me.
Right.
And there's an egoistic side to me. And the ego in me, which is probably just as strong, or maybe, unfortunately, a little stronger than the other areas,
right.
Says, I'd love to make more money. I'd love to be able to do more good things. I think that's human nature. I think it's normal.
What's the biggest lesson that you have learned?
I don't know if I've learned very well. I'm still looking to learn, you know.
Mm-hmm, that's good.
I keep making the same mistakes. Two
mistakes?
And three and four
like what?
Times.
Like what?
Well,
give an example.
I'll be too trusting. That's one of the things that I'll learn a lesson about something, and mm-hmm. It'll have to do. This is just the first thing that came to mind.
Right.
Has to do with being very kind of naive, you know, and that goes with maybe coming from the South. Mm-hmm. And I'll remind myself of the kid on the cover of Mad Magazine, you know, with his mouth open, going. And I'll go, really? And I get sucked in again and again and again. And I think I've learned the lesson, but I really haven't.
Managements. That's one lesson. Do you think you let them handle your career? Or do you handle your career?
Well,
would you say?
Now I handle my career.
Mm-hmm.
But when I was young, managers handled my career. But I was lucky there, you know. That was one of the areas I was really lucky. The guys that
right.
handled me were the best. They were honest, mm-hmm. and they really had connections. And they helped to put me where I got to at such a young age.
Right.
And I was lucky because I know so many horror stories.
Tommy Sands, you just said the word. I like that when a star like yourself say, I'm lucky. You are lucky.
Well, yeah.
You know people out there should say, I'm lucky, and they're not. And they're bitter about it. You're not bitter, are you?
I'm not at all.
That's
what's to be bitter about?
Good. That's what's about. Hollywood's full of bitterness about, and there should be lucky. Hey, they are lucky, man. You know, that's what I love about you just now, what you're saying. Pat Boone, you worked in a movie, and I'm going to say, he's still there, works on top. What
well,
makes
he's
it?
Wonderful. He's a bright, intelligent, oh my God, when he was 20 years old, he was magna cum laude at
right.
Columbia University. He was also a movie star at the same time.
Right.
He was also a gigantic record star. The guy can, he's really, he's just capable of doing 20 different things, all of them well at the
right.
same time. He's a wonderful man. Mm-hmm. He is probably one of the five men that I admire most in the whole world. He's raised his children the right way. Uh-huh. He's given them a good set of realistic values and morals.
Uh-huh.
I admire Pat Boone a lot. Now, a lot of people put him down for various reasons.
Religious,
you know,
faiths and
whatever.
Stuff like that. Whatever.
Yeah.
The vice president's thing. Yeah.
But he's such a wonderful man, and he's been such a great father, a wonderful husband. I'm not saying that anyone is perfect. He wrote the book, of course, and told all, and he told about the problems that they've had, but mm-hmm. he's a human being, and we all have problems, but he's a wonderful man.
Writing a book?
No.
Tommy, come on. Everyone's writing a book here.
No.
Aren't you going to write a book?
I want to wait until...
You had a great life,
I got to have the ending first,
okay.
So maybe on my deathbed I'll say, please, copy this down.
Are you still friends with Nancy? You still call her up and all that? Or
no.
Speak?
No?
No. You haven't speak?
No?
Don't say anything? Don't say
no.
Because you moved to Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about your life in Hawaii. How was it?
Oh,
when you
I
packed
was...
your bags and left.
Yeah.
Tell mm-hmm. me, why Hawaii? I hate the sun.
I'm probably the world's only Jewish beach boy, you know.
No, they're all there in Miami Beach, Johnny.
But not in Hawaii.
They're there.
I always loved the tropics. I don't know. I had a fascination with it.
Uh-huh.
And right after the divorce, I wanted to move. I wanted to continue singing, and I did.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to move to Hawaii. I'd always toyed with that idea.
Uh-huh.
There was nothing holding me here, and I moved.
Uh-huh.
In 67, I moved over there and didn't come back here, really. Although I always worked, and I kept going back and forth. But I lived there for 20 years and didn't get back here until 88.
Oh, God. 20 mm-hmm. years.
I love Hawaii.
You sound like Bobby Breen. He lives in Miami Beach.
Yeah, I work for him.
Bobby,
and his wife.
Yeah, he's an agent, isn't he?
Yeah.
Bobby
and
Green.
I work for them every once in a while.
Yeah, you work Miami Beach, huh?
That's right.
It's great. It's great there. What's your happiest memories about Hollywood? Do
oh,
you have
my,
any?
Well, my happiest memories are just...
being with Elvis and all that? Or
those are all wonderful memories. But the greatest thing that I think of is that I was one of the lucky few people that had a dream and that thank God and thank this business and thank whatever caused
yeah.
it. Thank Colonel Parker. I was able to realize my dream, and there's so many people that have a dream and, you know, maybe they don't go for it for one reason or another.
Right.
And that's the one thing that whenever I'm asked to go out and to talk to kids in schools,
yeah.
I always say, if you know, go for your dream.
Go for your dream.
Because I don't care who you are or what kind of an education or what kind of money or lack of money you have. Everybody can do it. I am not a real talented man, but I had drive, I had some luck, I had God, and I was able to realize my dream, you know?
Yeah,
and
Tommy,
it can happen to anybody.
Tommy Sands, you should go out talking more like this and let these young kids know more about this.
Well, it's,
you can
it's,
help a lot of kids, because that is so true. That is so true.
It's true,
saying.
You know.
Because when there's a dream out there, you make up your mind, go for it, persistence is it, and go
exactly.
for it. Am I right?
The worst thing that can happen is you'd be happy, but you didn't become a star because you'd be doing
not
what you love to do.
It's Tommy said, not everybody can become a star, and
exactly.
not everybody wants to be a star.
I was as happy when I was singing for $5 a night as I was when I became successful because I was doing what I love to do.
You're a singer. You
exactly.
like to entertain, see?
Yeah.
Working with Jack Nicholson. Come on, tell me about Jack Nicholson and you.
Oh,
Tommy Sands, what film was that in?
That was in Ensign Pulver.
Ah.
Josh Logan film, and Josh was great at casting people. He was another one like Colonel Parker who had a good eye.
He had a good eye. Yeah.
That film, there were so many young people who hadn't made it yet that were about to explode. There was Jack Nicholson.
Right.
I think he had done maybe one film or two films before that, but I'm not sure. That may have been
uh-huh.
his first picture.
Right.
There was James Ferrantino.
James
there
Ferrantino.
There was Jimmy Coco, Peter Marshall. Just, I know uh-huh. I'm leaving some people out, but yeah. there must have been 10 or 12 young men mm-hmm. that were just about to explode and become major stars. Uh-huh. And they were all in that yeah. little film.
Tell me about the days of you and Fabian and Frankie Up. I mean, you all guys came around that area. How did you feel to be along with Fabian, Tommy Sands, and, you know, you all guys were teen idols. It must have been great to walk into a theater backstage and these girls are screaming at you guys.
Oh, it was wonderful. Because I had a tough time with girls when I was in high school, like most 99% of the guys.
Right.
You're bashful. I'm not a jock. You know, I wasn't 6'10" and wasn't on the football team. And so I had a tough time getting uh-huh. a date. And to suddenly get a record contract and and have a few girls, it was like, aha, you know, I was in heaven.
I heard Tommy Sands was bashful. I am sitting talking to you now. I'm looking at you. You are shy.
Yeah.
You are shy. You had a problem at the beginning, and you went to see a psychiatrist shyness.
I still go to a psychiatrist.
Well, I do too.
I have all.
I don't know why, but
all through
I do.
The years, it's
you
helped
still
me
go.
A lot. Mm-hmm.
What was the reason?
We work on various things. That just helps me a lot. It's good to find somebody who's got some fresh ideas and some better ideas than you have.
Tommy Sands drinks?
No.
Never took drugs.
Yeah, I did. I went through my drug and drinking phase. Yeah.
You did.
And during the 60s, and was smoking like I don't know how many packs a day. Yeah. And
you don't smoke anymore.
I don't smoke.
No drugs.
Or drink,
no, drink?
Or no drugs. Yeah.
Good. That's
don't
funny.
Do any of it.
That's
it's
funny.
Not that I think that necessarily. You know, taking a drink now and then is horrible. If you're the right kind of person, I'm not the right kind of person.
Right.
When I do something, I will do it to excess, if whatever it is. And so I know that drinking is not for me.
You got that rockabilly roots, don't you? That's that rockabilly roots down there in Louisiana. I know you're from Chicago, but still Chicago's rockabilly roots too, you know.
Oh, that was so exciting because rockabilly was formed right there. Elvis and Jerry Lee and Roy Orbison and a few people like that. You know, it all began out of nothing. There was nobody singing like that, and it was so exciting to be there at the time and to be part of it, you know. Uh-huh. Rockabilly started right then.
You've got so many awards. You've done so many television shows. You've worked in Europe, all over Europe, all over Australia. You're a big hit in Australia. Matter of fact, you just got back. And now you're on your way up in Northwest.
I have to play Australian countries out of the United States. All my bill collectors keep chasing me, you know, and I go here, I go there. Uh-huh.
But you work here. You work in America a lot.
Oh, yeah.
You have a new record out right now?
Well, we're getting ready to go down to Nashville and do an album.
Uh-huh.
We've been working on that for a long time, and I haven't done a new record in many, many years, and this will be our first.
Tommy Sands, where would you like to see yourself 5 years from now?
I'd like to be singing, and I'd like to be making records on a regular basis, because to me the most fun of being a singer is in the studio, and it's working on a new creation, working on a song, then hearing it put down and putting the arrangement to it. That's where it's at. That's
you're married now? Been married? How long?
No.
You're not married now?
No, I was married again. I have a 17-year-old daughter.
Teenage daughter?
Yeah.
Singer? Actress?
Well, she loves to sing, but she's going to college next year. She's in her last year in high school. Uh-huh. And she wants to be an anchor woman.
Good.
So she's going to major in journalism.
Great.
And I'm very proud of her.
Uh-huh. Tommy Sands, the book has got to come out, Tommy. It's just...
There's no end.
Talking to you today, it's very refreshing. Makes me feel very warm to know that someone is very, very honest with himself and knows where he is. You know who you are now, don't you?
Well, I'm finding out. You know, I'm getting a better look, I guess, day by day.